It's good to have the ensemble up here singing. And kind of projects it out as we respond. Turn, if you will, in your Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter number 3. 2 Timothy chapter number 3. And we're going to be looking at from verses number 10 on down to verse number 17. Second Timothy chapter number 3 and verse number 10. The Apostle Paul writes to Timothy and thus to the rest of us. He says, "And thou hast fully known my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience, persecutions, afflictions which came unto me at Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra, what persecutions I endured, but out of them all the Lord delivered me. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived." Verse 14, he says, "But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus." That's the key verse this morning that we'll be dwelling on in verse number 15, that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, and this is the phrase I'd like to emphasize, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Peter read for us from Psalm 111, and I'd like you to turn back to that eventually and just put your finger in it. We'll be referring to that later on in the message. But if you can't find the Psalms, just pretty much go to the middle of your Bible and open up. You're probably going to hit the Psalms. And then go to Psalm 111. In verse number 10, the psalmist writes this: "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all they that do His commandments. His praise endureth forever." Over the last several weeks, I was preaching a series on the Sermon on the Mount, and then at the last couple of messages, we were talking about building your house. You're building upon a foundation, which is none other than Jesus Christ. And as we mentioned last week, he said that the wise man does that. And then we referred to Proverbs 1 when it talks about what a wise man looks like and what he does. I think that would be a good passage for you to consider. But what we read this morning is the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all they that do His commandments, and His praise endureth forever. Then thousands of years, quite a bit later, Paul writes to Timothy, and he tells him that from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Jesus Christ. I want you to make that connection there about wisdom and understanding and what it means for our salvation and what it means for the life that we live. We often are hearing the phrase today that we are living in unprecedented times. How many times have you heard that? That saying has been prevalent across our media. Of course, the world in 2020 has never been more connected globally, both through travel, although lately it hasn't, and through technology especially. You know, at any time, somebody can say something in one part of the world and a reaction will occur in another part of the world almost instantaneously. We've never had that before. So in that regard, we are living in unprecedented times. The population of the planet contains billions more people than any other time in history. So with this COVID-19 restrictions and the implications of it for public health and for the social contact that we're going through and for the global economy, we are certainly living in a time that we haven't seen before. It's a time that we haven't seen before. However, throughout world history, we've seen wars that have devastated people, whole continents. In fact, in the last century, we saw two world wars. Diseases have plagued entire countries across the world. We often hear comparisons of the Spanish flu that occurred 100 years ago that killed, and I get this, 50 million people died 100 years ago because of the Spanish flu worldwide. There was also the bubonic plague of the Middle Ages that it just goes back in history, but that devastated Europe. So in that regard, we are not living in unprecedented times. We are going through cycles that we see in world history. But what is happening in our culture today is more than physical epidemic. We're not just living in an unprecedented time. We are living in a perilous time. Look what it says in 2 Timothy chapter number 3 and verse number 1. The Apostle Paul, we must put what he said to Timothy in a context here. He says here that you're wise, you know, salvation and so forth. You have the word of God that teaches you this. What is the context of that? Look at verse number 1. This know also that in the last days, perilous times shall come. The King James uses the word perilous. Other versions use difficult, dangerous, and so forth. But perilous is a very powerful word. In fact, in the Greek, from which this is translated from, there's only two passages in this New Testament that uses that word perilous in the Greek. And it's translated two different ways. Here it's translated perilous. In another portion, in Matthew chapter number 8, where Jesus is dealing with two demonic men who were out of their minds, it uses that same word. And it says that they were fierce. And as we go through that passage, which we're not going to take the time to look at it, we go through that passage, we find out that these men were out of their minds, but when they met Jesus, they were in the right mind. People were afraid of them. They were going around doing things that were absolutely horrible, and people were afraid, but after they met Jesus Christ, they were in a sound mind. Interesting, as I began to read about that, and I thought, you know, we definitely live in perilous times. But the perilous times that he's talking about here, the difficult, dangerous, mind-altering times that we live in have really nothing to do with epidemics, have nothing to do with disasters around the planet. But the reactions are the same. Have a look at verses number 2, right on down. He says here that men shall be lovers of their own selves. They're covetous. They're boasters. They're proud. They're blasphemers. You know what a blasphemer is? A blasphemer takes the exalted name of God and it brings it down, tramples it down. It becomes part of their language. They forget the sovereignty of God and they put the so-called sovereignty of man in its place. They switch it around. He says here, he says by doing that, they are disobedient in their own family relationships to parents. They're unthankful. They're unholy. They're without natural affection. What that means there is that they are actually very cruel to the very family members that they have. You know, one of the biggest disasters that we have in our society today is domestic violence. The home is falling apart. Statistics are showing that when the dad leaves the home and the family falls apart, there's a rebellion involved there. And that's what we're seeing. These are perilous times that you and I are living in today, for we are living in the last days. This isn't all going to be gloom and doom, believe me. There's some really, really good news that's coming. But it's not the good news that's going to be coming from people who have those attitudes that they are truth breakers, false accusers, they're incontinent. Now, incontinent means that they have no self-control. They just can't control themselves. Everything's extreme with them. They're fierce. They're despisers of those that are good. In other words, they despise truth. They despise anything that's righteous. And they turn it around. He says that they are also, and this is the main thing, they're traitors, they're heady, they're high-minded, they're lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. The most significant part of this is found in verse 5, though. They have a form of godliness, but they deny the power thereof. From such turn away. So the very ones who say that they are working in the power of God do not have the power of God dwelling within them. What's the key difference? The key difference is what he's going to tell Timothy in just a few moments. And he goes on, he talks about how he used some visual pictures there of how silly they are and how vulnerable the people are. They're ever learning. They're never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. He's painting such a terrible picture here, but he goes all the way back to Moses, and he talks about how the magicians in verse number 8 opposed Moses. You know how they opposed Moses? They counterfeited what Moses did. When Moses went in there and he said, "Let my people go," you may remember the story that God told Moses that there'll be certain plagues that will come upon the people. And so Moses would do the plagues, and the magicians would immolate it, do the exact same thing up to a point. They counterfeited the power of God. It was a counterfeit. And he says right here in verse number 8 that they are men of corrupt minds, reprobate concerning the faith. The word reprobate literally means a counterfeit. It looks the same, but it's not the same. That's the perilous times that we've been. Now, I know that you and I are very much consumed with the economics that's going on right now. We're very much consumed about the health, and we should be. We should be very concerned about that. But that's not what makes these times today perilous. What makes them perilous is that we've forgotten what truth is. We've forgotten what it means to actually understand the sovereignty of God. We put that away and we say, it's going to be okay. We're all in this together. We're looking for governments to find us a solution. We're looking for scientists to find us a vaccine. And they will. They will. And we will get through this. But that's not the issue today. For we will still be in a perilous time. If you take the time to look at the news, you will see that that's exactly what's going on around the world right now. In various aspects. But I don't want to dwell on that today because that's not really my message today. My message today is what the Apostle Paul is indicating here about how in verse number 13, I'm going to kind of emphasize this a little bit more because I want you to understand why this is so perilous, okay? Because if we don't get that, then we won't understand why the gospel is so good. In verse number 13, he says, "But evil men and seducers," those are imposters, "they shall wax worse." They'll go from bad to worse. "Worse and worse," he says, "they are deceiving, and they themselves are deceived." Well, of course they are, because they're ever learning. They're never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. It has been observed that, and I'm going to do a quote here. I think this comes from Schaefer or one of these. He said, they're overestimating human capabilities while minimizing humanity's uniqueness, and that's a product of the postmodern worldview. Now, I threw that in there for some of you who read deeply and you're looking and you're saying, what's going on here? We are definitely in a post-Christian society today. The message that we're hearing today is a unique message. It's a message that you and I have. If we know Jesus Christ is Savior, we don't need to be adding things to the message. We don't need to be trying to water it down to make it acceptable. We need to just simply proclaim the message. The message will do the work. And that's what he's saying to Timothy here, and he's warning him. Remember what the psalmist says. In Psalm 111. Now, this is the time that you could turn back to that. Some of you prepared in advance, and you've got the page right there. Have a look at verses number 7 through 10. And look what the psalmist said. The first part of that, verses 1 through 6, I will be showing you some of that this evening in relationship to work. But in verse number 7, he says, the works of his hands. So what's the works of God's hands? They're verity and judgment. All his commandments are, well, they're sure. They stand steadfast forever and ever. The commandments of the Lord, the truth of the Lord, the veracity of the Lord is still here today and is just as rich to us today as it was when the psalmist penned this. He says here that they stand fast forever and ever and are done in truth and righteousness. And here's how he does it. This is where you find Jesus in the Psalms. He sent redemption unto his people. See, he didn't say, you must find truth yourself. He didn't say that. He doesn't say, do the best you can, and I will help you through this. He doesn't say that. He says, it's about me, and I will redeem you. Isn't that wonderful? That's wonderful because you and I get very frustrated when we try to. I heard on the news a commentation this week that they said it's like our government leaders are climbing a slippy pole. They can't get up the pole. They keep sliding down all the time, and they're looking for answers all the time. Let me tell you something, folks. The Bible tells us in the Psalms that a child who knows the Scriptures knows more than his teachers. Because he's got wisdom and understanding. And the gospel gives us that. He says in verse number 9, he sent redemption unto his people. He hath commanded his covenant, that's his agreement, forever. Why? How can he do that? Because holy and reverent is his name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all they that do his commandments. His praise endureth forever. So this morning, we lifted up our voices in praise to our Lord. And it may not have sounded so good and so professional and everything like that, but let me tell you what, it was a blessing to God. And when the angels who are observing church services around this world right now, they're looking and they're in wonderment as to why and how God would redeem such as you and I so that we return our praise to the Lord. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. How should we respond to a society that is in peril today? Well, first of all, we need to understand they're in peril. You shouldn't be in peril. That's not you. Paul reminds Timothy in verses number 10 through 17 what he has. And this is such a blessing for you and I to understand. So he reminds Timothy, and I'm going to jump around here. I don't have it quite in the verse order, but I have it in the thought order of my thoughts anyway. He says in verse number 15, first of all, we have salvation. We have salvation, verse 15. And that salvation is through faith in Jesus Christ. There is an answer. There is an answer. And that answer is the answer. And as we go and we face the society that we're facing here today, let's not be sidetracked with the issues that come and go. For next week, if the government declared that the pandemic was finished and everything's back to normal, we probably would just go right back to normal and forget, because we're listening to some authority out there, and we trust that authority. And then we will walk away, as James warns us, when we see the word and we walk away and we are forgetful here. We're not remembering what the word reflected back to us. You and I need salvation. We need reconciliation with God before we have reconciliation with each other. We need not to forget that. That's what makes the church having a unique message in this world. The clarity and call of the world, of the gospel goes out and it pierces the darkness. And it reaches right into the heart of a person's soul and the need that they have with the Lord. He reminds Timothy that the circumstances are not an indication of your relationship with God. Persecution normally is. Look what it says in verse number 10 and 11. He says, "But thou hast fully known my doctrine." In other words, the things I believe, my manner of life, the way I live, the purpose for my life. He says, "Are my faith, long suffering, my charity or my love, and my patience, persecutions, afflictions came unto me." The Apostle Paul, of all people, had the power of the gospel living within his life, and yet he suffered persecution over and over and over again. And he says in verse number 12, "Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution." The world says, let's insulate ourselves from pain. Let's insulate ourselves from anything that will cause us to feel insecure. We will produce payments that our grandchildren will be paying for so that we can feel secure in this society right now. That's not in my notes, and I may regret saying that. But that's exactly what's happening. Let's not trade temporary security for standing up for what the gospel has done in our life, because Paul says, "Yea, all that will live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer." It's part of our life. They killed our Lord. And we are followers of Jesus Christ. And you say, well, if you send a message like that, I tell you what, it's not going to be a message that's going to be accepted. Oh, but it's a message that will be accepted. You're here. You're listening to it. Many people raised up their voices and they sang praise to the Lord. That's the testimony that we have. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, I've got some very good and clear news for you in just a moment. But what you've been witnessing today is the power of the gospel in changed lives. He, in verse number 14, encourages Timothy to, look at verse 14, this is so important, to continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. Continue in it. You know, your salvation may have occurred at a point in time, but your growth continues. And as Peter told us, he says that we go after the sincere milk of the word that we may grow thereby. Continue in the word. You know, the thing about it, I'm so pleased to see you. We haven't been able to meet for like 12 weeks, something like that. And then last week we met, and next week, and you came back. Continue in the word. But it's not just coming to church. It's actually growing in the gospel. The Bible tells us that we're not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is. But as you see the day approaching, we're to be exhorting, involved in each other's lives. That's why our small groups should be growing, not shrinking during times like this. This is why we need to be more involved in praying for one another, in bearing one another's burdens, in exhorting and encouraging one another with the gospel of Jesus Christ during times like this. In fact, one of my first sermons when this whole thing happened was in times like these. You need a Savior. Let's keep that continuing involved in our life. Let's not rest on the past knowledge. Let's not say, well, I've got a position, and so therefore here's what I am, and that's that. Now let's grow in faith and in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Because in verse 15, he says that we are wise unto salvation through faith. Now, for the next few minutes, let me talk about what that means. There's so much more we can talk about here, but through time's sake, maybe we'll elaborate on this later, but which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. Notice he says that from a child in verse 15, Timothy knew through the Holy Scriptures. Those scriptures that he's talking about was the Old Testament. The scriptures of the New Testament were still being written. So in other words, what Paul is saying here is by the Old Testament and all the things that were written in the Old Testament, Jesus says that the law of Moses, the prophets, and also the poetry, he says, all speak about me. And so he says here, he says, those were to drive you to a place where you would have salvation through Jesus Christ. So now let's turn back to 2 Timothy chapter 1, and let's see what that looks like. Just in our closing remarks, if you know anything about my closing remarks, 2 Timothy chapter number 1, and I think this will bless your heart. It says in verse number 6, wherefore I put thee in remembrance. Remember, this is the same letter. Okay, this is the same letter. This is the context. There, wherefore I put thee in remembrance that thou stir up the gift of God which is in thee by the putting on my hands. In verse 7, for God hath not given us a spirit of fear. You know, he hasn't given us a spirit of fear. He's given us power and love and a sound mind. Do you remember that perilous times? Do you remember the two times it was used in the New Testament had to do with somebody being out of control in his mind? How many times have we heard on the news is they're out of control? Where are we going here? What's happening? Well, the believer has the spirit of power and love and a sound mind. So where does that come from? Look at verse number 8. But be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me as prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel. The gospel, that's the power, according to the power of God. Verse number 8, he says that the gospel, what is the gospel? It's the good news that's proclaimed that Jesus Christ died for sinners, and he redeems sinners. Look at verse number 9. He says, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works. No, no, you can't be good enough. Your good enough is never good enough. He says, no, no. He says, but according to his own purpose and the grace which was given to us in Christ Jesus before the world began. This has not caught God by surprise. This has not caught God as saying, oh, I better come up with a new solution and an answer to meet this particular issue right now. No, before the world began, Jesus Christ, it was destined that he would die for your sins and he would redeem you. That's the power of the gospel. That was his purpose. It says in verse number 10, but now is made manifest by the appearing of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who hath abolished death. Here's how he did it. He abolished death. He has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. It reminds me of that famous passage in Ephesians chapter number 2 in verses 4 through 9. And I'm going to read it very slowly because we need to remember what is said here. But Ephesians chapter 2 in verse number 4 through 9, where we've seen what is salvation? What does it mean when Timothy was told that the scriptures make you wise unto salvation. But God, who is rich in mercy for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace we are saved. And hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us, how? Through Christ Jesus. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. You remember what a perilous time involved? involve people who are boasters. We can do this our way. We will get through this. And he says, no, you're saved by grace. It's not of your own action. God's the one that made the move. He says, for we are his workmanship. We're created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. So believer, let me tell you, the good news is during these perilous times that you and I are living in, these are the times when we actually, our light will shine the best. It will shine the furthest. The salt has not lost its savor because the salt is in Christ Jesus. And when you and I move away from Jesus Christ, then we've got ourselves what Paul warned to the Galatians, a false gospel. And not just a false gospel, it's a damning gospel. It will send people to destruction. Keep that gospel clean. Keep it pure. Keep it simple. It is the gospel wherewith we believe. And Paul said it this way. He said in 1 Corinthians 15, he says in verse number 10 that he abolished death, gave life and immortality. But in 1 Corinthians 15, familiar passage. I love this passage. Paul said to a church, moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preach unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also you are saved. If you keep in memory what I preached unto you, lest you have been vain, he said, because you can so easily move away from that. He says, for I delivered unto you first of all, which also I received. Here it is. Christ died for our sins, according to the Scripture. He died for our sins. And that he was buried, and that he rose again third day, according to the Scripture. You know, in verse number 12 of our passage in 2 Timothy 1, he said that he was suffering, he was not ashamed. He's confident. His confidence was not in his own ability. He says, because I know whom I've believed. I believe we sang about that this morning, actually. I know whom I've believed, and I'm persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him that day. Believer in Jesus Christ, let me tell you something. You may be going through trials right now. You may be going through the deepest, darkest time of your life right now. But let me tell you, God has not given up on you because God has not given up on Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ dwells within you. Many times we say today that God has not given up on you because you're good enough. That's not what the gospel says. The gospel says that God will keep you because you're in Christ. Look what it says in verse number 14. He says, that good thing which was committed unto us, keep by the Holy Ghost which dwelleth in us. This is the time when you and I have this opportunity to speak the gospel into other people's lives. We have the opportunity to show that that gospel is not something that we're ashamed of because it's not something that has let us down. We often think today that, you know, the power in the church is in the power of the programs. And it's not. It's the power of the preaching is in the power of the message. And the message is the message that Jesus Christ came to save sinners. So let me ask you something. Could it be that maybe during these last several weeks and months, perhaps years, that we've been sidetracked by the events of the world? And when it was going really, really good, we were actually sidetracked by that. Could it be? Remember, the power of the gospel in your life is Jesus Christ. And as Paul told Timothy, continue in that. It might be that you need to go back to that and remember that. Perhaps you've become weary in well-doing. You need to go back to what Jesus told the church there. You've left your first love. And what's happened is you've grown lukewarm. Maybe that's an issue. Well, let me tell you something. God invites you to come back. All you that labor and heavy laden, he says, I will give you rest. maybe you're listening to this message right now, either right here or perhaps on the web right now, and you're listening to it, and you need that gift of salvation that can only be found in Jesus Christ alone. Well, first of all, you need to admit that you are a sinner in God's eyes. Most everybody will say, yep, of course I'm a sinner. And then they normally give a little laugh. That means they really don't understand what that means. If you are a sinner in the eyes of God, and our God judges in truth and in justice, just like we read in Psalm 11, and you're a sinner, you're in big trouble. You're in a major difficulty. You are in a peril right now. The Bible says in Romans 3, he says, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. And one of the perils of mankind is to say, that's not true. We are righteous. There's goodness in you. That's not true. Everything that we do is evil continually. Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned and come short of God's glory, because that's the key. That's the issue here. But the wonderful truth is that if you receive the redemption and justification that is only found in the grace of Jesus Christ, you will be saved. You will have salvation. That's the good news. Christian, if you just keep to the message, you keep to the news, the good news, and look what God can do in your life. In Romans 3:24, I read Romans 3:23, but in verse 24, the very next verse, he says, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. You receive that free gift that he offers you. Romans 3:25 says, and here it is, it's through faith in his blood to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins. In other words, the sacrificial death of Jesus Christ paid the penalty for your sins and for my sins. It provides the way for your forgiveness. You just need to receive him as your Savior. Admit that you're a sinner in God's eyes. Now, I don't understand all this. Neither do I. I don't understand all the workings of God, but the Bible says that his ways are not my ways. But I do understand that Jesus Christ came to this earth and lived a perfect life. God in the flesh, Emmanuel, we sang a few moments ago. And he died for my sins. Many years ago, I bowed my knee at my mother's bedside, actually, and I called upon the name of the Lord. Even a child can understand. Accept that Jesus Christ is my personal Savior. And so can you. In verse number 26 of Romans 3, he says that he makes you the justifier. He's the justifier of him that believes in Jesus. Put your faith and your trust in Jesus Christ. You say, is it just that simple? It is just that simple. But it's also that complex, isn't it? Because what he does is he takes you and he turns you into a new person. Your sins are washed away and you're forgiven. That guilt is gone through Jesus Christ. The song that we're going to close with today is an invitational song. It asks a question. He says, would you be free from the burden of sin? Is that really what you want? You want to be free from that burden of sin? Well, there's power in the blood. Would you over evil a victory win? Would you repent of your sin? Would you say, look, I want the victory over the sin? He says, don't just make more and more rules in your life. No, go through the blood of Christ. There's power in the blood. Would you be free from your passion and pride? Most people say, no, I don't want to be free from my passion and pride. It's my passion and it's my pride that drives me. It's going to drive you to an eternity separated from God. Would you be free from that? He says there's power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. Would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? Some of us have sins that just so easily beset us, and they're continually playing in our hearts and our minds. Would you like that freedom? He says, well, there's power in the blood. The sin stains are lost in its life-giving flow. Would you do service for Jesus who came? You want to continue to serve him? Don't forget there's power in the blood. Would you live daily his praises to sing? There's power in the blood. And the people said, amen. Amen to that. Let's close in a word of prayer. And I'm going to ask if you can prepare to sing that song. And as your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed, perhaps this is the time when you need to accept Jesus as your personal Savior. Christian, perhaps this is the time that you need to actually review what has been your message. Is it a message that is self-satisfying? A message that absorbs itself with the activities of the planet, just trying to get through? Are you looking at the eternal aspect?